I'm speaking about the topic embedding without disruption. What do I mean? If we want to embed sensor function into materials, the first part of the talk I will generally discuss how could this work, and then I will explain you some examples. So the first will be okay. So first we will discuss how to integrate sensors in a material, generally what possibilities are there. The typical problems we have, the challenges technology has on that. I will discuss several examples. Two examples from my group, several examples from other groups, and then there will be a summary. I have a material. I want to have a sensor function in the material. What could I do? Principally, I see four possibilities. I could make a small sensor and integrate it. Hybrid approach. I could locally grow a sensor, for example, by printing. We have heard some of those approaches this morning. I could use a generic property of the material. This works very well, for example, in metals. But possibilities are limited. Not all materials are so kind to give us information. And the last one, I could really generically, locally grow sensors. That's the way nature does it. But at the moment, I see no way to do it as a technologist. So this is far off. And I will focus on the first one. I will speak about hybrid integration, making a small sensor and integrate it. Now, a nice example for a material is a carbon fiber reinforced polymer. This is the materials modern airplanes are made from and the wings of the big wind energy plants are made from. And there are several sensor functions should be integrated in the material. And if I imagine this carbon fiber material, the fiber filaments have some microns. There are sensors available which are maybe 100 microns thick. I could laminate them into the material. And what would happen when the wing of the airplane goes down 10 million times? The following would happen. Sooner or later, the sensor turns out to be a problem. Because the sensor is not adapted, so there will be a large strain here, and there will be a delamination. And the question is how to prevent this. So, my to-do, my task is, I want to embed a sensor, and the sensor has to provide the information I need for monitoring. But the sensor does not downgrade the macroscopic behavior of the material. How to achieve this? A vision could be this one. Imagine fibers, sensor fibers, which have about the same size than the carbon laminate fibers, and the same surface. So, I don't use a big sensor, I use a sensor net from very tiny fibers. Similar size and the material structures. I must look at surface adhesion that must fit with the polymer matrix. I must look at thermal matching, I must look at elastic matching. My sensors must be at least in the same way elastic than the material, better a little bit more. And I must look into electrical connection. Connection wires can also be a problem. And of course, as always, the last point, I must look into energy, but actually that's a different story. Another approach to look at this is I compare two pressure sensors. This is from our clean room in Bremen. This is from an animal skin. Actually, this is a 50 micron sensor cell. It's called a Merkel's disc. It's a pressure sensor. And this, here we took it from the skin of a rat. The interesting thing is the following. The sensor membranes here, that's a surface micromachine capacitive pressure sensor. The sensor membranes are also about 50 microns. We can have a closer look at the sensor membranes. that's typical polysilicon over a gap made by a sacrificial layer. So the sensor membranes is the same size, but the sensor is much larger. But I don't need this. I only need the surface. Most of this down here of all the silicon is just ballast. I have a lot of parasitic volume. And the question is how to get rid of it. But before, yeah, how to get rid of it? This means I want to focus on those layers on top which really contribute to the sensor function. The bulk silicon does not in this case. And that's the approach I call function scale integration. Leave off everything which is not really necessary for the sensor function. This brings me from a sensor chip to a sensor foil, and then to a sensor net. But of course, this ballast has its reason. Intelligent engineers make sensors which have more mass than they need, and they have a reason to do it. So I'm looking into the reasons people have to make this mass. And I found three. First, sometimes mass is needed for the function. Second, it's easier to fabricate on full wafer level. The third reason, packaging is easier with thick sensors. And now I look into details of those three points. Do I need mass for sensor function? Principally, in most cases, not. Because most sensor functions go with the surface. And if I downscale, we all know surface effects are winners. Because when I downscale, length to the square wins against length to the power of 3. So many, many sensor functions, capillary forces, adhesion, humidity, gas sensors, are winners of miniaturization. Sometimes there's a noise issue. For example, in the accelerometer, you can be very small, but not totally small, because then there will be thermal noise. But if you really calculated this noise effect, only happens if you get really, really, really small, much smaller than we are today. This means actually the needing of the mass for the sensor function normally is not the case for the mass. So I look into fabrication. We all know that silicon wafers are quite easy to handle. That's given technology. They have typically 500 micron thickness. When I thin down my silicon to 20 micron, it's also easy to handle. 20 micron silicon is flexible, smooth, it doesn't break. The problem is in between. It's 100 microns. 100 micron thick silicon is troublemaking. It's brittle, it breaks. So it's very difficult to get extremely thin silicon devices. A very interesting example how to achieve this we have just been hearing in this room in the last session. And worldwide, many groups are at the moment working on this topic to come from the thick wafer device, thick chip device, to a foil. Most of the groups make their devices on a thick wafer, then reduce the thickness. Third point why I have parasitic mass is, I have some examples of this here before we come to the third point. The whole thin chip business started with RFID technology. About 15, 20 years ago, people wanted to make thin RFID chips. I don't think you can see it. It's a human finger with two little black dots. Those are RFID chips, 200 microns in size, 20 micron thick. That's when the first thin chips were made, by making it on full silicon and then thinning. That's an ultra-thin chip on foil made by University of Stuttgart. This is a thermal flow sensor also on a membrane of polyimide made by our clean room in Bremen. An interesting thing you can see here, and that brings us to packaging, is the sensor is very thin, ultra-thin, but they still have bond pads. If you want to use an ultra-thin sensor, of course, you have to think also of other methods to bond it. And this brings us to the third issue, packaging. If I imagine a thin foil embedded directly into material, I have no housing material anymore. Today, I develop a chip and I develop a housing process, and the materials for housing are adapted to silicon technology. If I directly embed a naked sensor with 10 micron thickness into polymer, I cannot do this. So the first material the chip sees is my matrix material. And on the one hand, this can make problems. On the other hand, scientifically, it's interesting. Because what I have to do now is to go to co-engineering of sensor technology and the processing of the material around. So, a lot of processes which do exist today for housing have been reinvented, re-evaluated. And I have to get rid of bond pads. So, one approach is to do the electric connection on wafer level, using very thin, flat interconnector bands. I'll show you an example soon. The next issue has been the elastic matching, the behavior of the elastic. If the material is bendable, the sensor has to be bendable too. If the material is stretchable, the sensor has to be stretchable too. And so many people think of how to make sensor structures bendable and stretchable. Essentially, there are two approaches here. I can make it by a wavy or zigzag design, or I can use materials which are more stretchable in themselves, going from metals, for example, to organic conducting materials. That's a very famous example, meanwhile, by Kim and Rogers for the use of a wavy design. And of course, there is a lot reserve of stretchability if you use such an approach. This is the first of my two examples from the IMSAS clean room. What we did here is we made a thermoelectric generator and we embedded it in metal, in aluminum, by casting. That's not function scale design, of course, it's very large and it's not bendable. But what I want to show you is two things. First, you can manage very high integration temperatures. Even high temperatures of material processing do not exclude integrating sensors. And second, if you use such a wavy design, you can manage very high processing stresses. Because if you put a sensor into hot molten aluminum and let it get solid, of course there will be a high stress. But the systems do survive it. So what you see here is interconnects. There are silicon interconnects and metal interconnects. And what you see here is a half-embedded device. That was just for the photo. Of course, we embed up to here when we really use it. But to see it better, we embedded half of it in aluminum. The idea of this generator is to be brought into a metal part while you cast the metal itself. And it works. Some measurements from it you can get for a thermoelectric converter comparatively high energies, around half a milliwatt, if you apply high temperatures. So this is a typical device. It's metal, which is to be used at very high differential temperatures. Okay, that's an example that we can manage high stresses, but that's of course not a material which moves, not an elastic material. So, I'll show you a second example, a capacitive sensor to be embedded in carbon fiber reinforced polymer. What does this sensor do? Carbon fiber reinforced polymer, that's the material the wings of airplanes are made from. or the wings of wind energy machines. Now, if you today produce wind energy plants, you laminate the wing, and then you wait 10 hours, then you are sure that the process of polymerization is finished. This means one plant can make one wind energy wing per day. Actually, if you would have a sensor which tells you about the ongoing of the process of polymerization, 2 hours would be enough. Then you could process 5 wings a day, which is of course better. But at the moment there is no possibility to detect it. Of course you could integrate a sensor, you could embed a sensor, but the sensor would stay in the wing. And since the sensor is too large, today you buy a sensor which is 1 centimeter. That's only useful for laboratory tests. Because a foreign body of 1 centimeter, 100 micrometer high, you cannot use it in the plant. The wind energy people would say, no, it's too dangerous. After 1 million cycles, it will break. So you need a sensor which is very small, very flexible, which can be embedded and can stay. And this is the idea of the device I'm going to show you. The sensor is a very thin foil. Here you find the interdigital structures. Oh yes, I have to say, what does it actually measure? It measures the dielectric function. Imagine you polymerize. You take carbon fibers and then you take the liquid polymer. And in the liquid polymer, the ions can move. Now, during polymerization, the polymer becomes solid. The ions cannot move anymore. And of course, if you have a capacity, you can detect this using dielectric spectroscopy. So, we have interdigital capacities here. Those are the interconnects, the electric interconnects. Those are kind of very thin flat bands you can put outside. And the whole structure is about 10 micrometer thick. How it's made, I don't go to the details due to lack of time. Basically, it's polyimide, it's a metal, and again, polyimide. The whole thing is made on a silicon wafer and then taken off the silicon. That's how it looks like. You have the interconnects, and this is the polyimide. If you embed this today, it looks like that. You see the thickness is okay. So those are the carbon fiber bundles. This is the sensor. And you can actually detect the process of polymerization. What do you see? This is temperature, the uppermost curve. So if polymerization starts, temperature is going to rise and then it's going to stabilize. And here you see, during this phase, the ions can move. Here they cannot move because it's cold. When it's getting warm, they start to move. They can move, but less and less. If the polymer solidifies, the movement of the ions is inhibited. And then you know here, it's finished. You can take this wing out, start with the next one. So, does the sensor measure okay? It does. Can it stay in the material? Actually, not yet. Because only one dimension is really ultra thin. It still is a foil as a foreign body, so it still would be a danger. And we have to think on. And the next generation, which is not yet processed, it's just being processed, you see here. So we would make holes in the foil, proceeding from a foil to a net. And then the polymer matrix can flow through and we come a little bit closer to the ideal of having just sensor fibers between the carbon fibers. If we look at this wound, I mean the foreign body of a sensor in a material. I say it's a wound in the material. I've been calculating how this size of the wound developed. The TO8, old TO8 housing was 10 millimeters. Then we got smaller and smaller. Paradise would be around 2 millimeters. And if we think of the sensor nets, we could go down to 50 micrometers sensor size, which would be hopefully much less effect of the wound on the material. What do we want to use it for? Of course, you know there is a lot of applications of having sensors inside materials for health monitoring to reduce service cost, for improving safety, to get lighter structures using less material, less energy consumption, using less material but having the same degree of security, for process control, manufacturing, and a number of applications in bio-inspired sensing. So, to sum up, what I want to do is to embed sensors in a way which does provide the information I want, but which does not downgrade by any means the mechanically macroscopic behavior of the materials. And to do this, I shrink them to the absolute minimum which is necessary for their function. I call this function scale integration. The most important step on housing now is that the matrix material becomes my first order housing material. So I have adapted my sensor technology and my matrix technology. And this leads me the way from a sensor chip to a sensor foil and in future to a sensor net. Thank you.